Welcome back to this course on blockchain and its applications. So till now we have discussed about different type of consensus protocols in blockchain, and you have seen the consensus models for the permissionless blockchain, where we talked about proof of work and its variants. And then we discussed about the permissioned blockchain consensus, where we have studied in details about Byzantine agreement protocols, and then we looked into the PBFT, the safety and liveness criteria of PBFT, and so on. Now, today we are going to look into that how those kind of consensus protocols can be applied on an enterprise blockchain architecture, and from there we are going to see that how you can develop a blockchain application that is more suitable for enterprise architectures. So with that, we'll give you an introduction about different type of models and protocols and architectures that are being followed in enterprise blockchains. And from there, we are going to discuss about some practical implementations about permission models for enterprise blockchain. And we are going to learn about one blockchain platform, which we call as the Hyperledger. Or more specifically, we are going to look into Hyperledger fabric architecture. Now, to start with, the broad concept that we are going to cover today is this idea of enterprise blockchain and how the blockchain is suitable for different kind of enterprise applications. And the different keywords that we have in today's talk are the applications in the enterprise blockchain domain, followed by we'll discuss in details about the different projects under Hyperledger Greenhouse. And then finally, we will touch upon Hyperledger Fabric, and in next lecture onwards, you will get a tutorial on how you can develop an application using Hyperledger Fabric. So to start with, if I just try to revisit the application space of blockchain, this is just a recap about what we have covered till now. So blockchain is a design pattern which was initially made famous by its use in Bitcoin. Well, so as we seen earlier during the discussion about the history of blockchain, the idea of blockchain got popular with the invention of Bitcoin, that provides a robust cryptocurrency architecture which can help you to utilize the cryptocurrencies beyond any border. So it might happen that you can utilize the cryptocurrencies for multiple different applications, for multiple different space, where no government or no bank can track you. So that is the kind of interesting space that this Bitcoin has developed, and that raised the interest of utilizing blockchain among people, and people started exploring different other applications which are possible on top of blockchain. And from that context, they have found out that we can design something called a smart contract, that with the help of blockchain you can automate our execution of codes in a complete decentralized architecture. And from that aspect, it becomes very much interesting to use blockchain in an enterprise space. So although Bitcoin was something that made blockchain popular, but if we just try to look into the different application space for blockchain, it is much more or much bigger than what Bitcoin can provide. So using blockchain, you can reimagine the world's most fundamental business interactions and open the door to invent new styles of digital interaction. So ideally, the business models that people have followed before the invention of blockchain was more kind of a centralized architecture. So where if multiple enterprise wants to coordinate or cooperate with each other, they will upload or they will share with data to some centralized party, which we call as the trusted third party, and that trusted third party will provide you all the information, and that will facilitate for sharing the information among individuals. But this kind of trusted third party never provides a kind of information where the trust is embedded. So it might happen that, well, the participants which want to collaborate or which want to cooperate with each other, they do not trust each other. So if say for example, if all the participating organizations are the big firms, then you can possibly trust them. But if there are new firms which are coming in the business, it becomes difficult to trust them, right? So if you just think about the different type of business models that we have, say for example, the e-commerce marketplace, where we use different type of e-commerce platform, including Amazon, Flipkart, eBay, and so on. So in all those platforms, there are different sellers who register themselves. And once the sellers are registering themselves to those platforms, then the buyers can choose their product and the buyer can buy them. Now, there is always a kind of question of trust for those sellers. So if the sellers is already an established seller, so then you can possibly trust it. But for a new seller, say for example, if tomorrow I try to sell certain product on Amazon or eBay, so the question comes that who is going to validate my authenticity or my identity. Obviously, the service provider here, which is Amazon or eBay or Flipkart, they are going to provide that. But interestingly, means whenever there is such kind of third party which is involved, the cost implication is also there that we discussed already in our previous lecture. So this kind of trusted third party who is facilitating the e-commerce marketplace, obviously they are going to also meet their own business, and because of which they will also need to have a share of what is being earned by the individual sellers. Well, so which will indirectly put up an bar on the prices of individual products. So it you might see that, well, sometime the price of certain products are much higher in Amazon or eBay or Flipkart compared to if you buy it from a local market. But and that increases just because the sharing of the profit between the individual seller and the service provider for the e-marketplace, because of which the price gets higher. So there are this kind of cost implications which are also there. Although this provides new type of business models, but then people started thinking of that if we can have a kind of complete decentralized architecture, but with a kind of decentralized e-marketplace, immediately you can think of that, well, to design such kind of distributed e-marketplace, who is going to validate the authenticity of individuals or authenticity of the individual sellers who are participating in the process. So what will happen that I participate in as a seller in a e-marketplace and then I turned out to be a fraudulent seller. So for example, I take the money from a customer and then I do not transfer my product to that customer. So if I do such kind of fraudulent behavior, who is going to track me and who is going to throw me out from the system? So blockchain provides such kind of opportunity to design a decentralized architecture, a decentralized marketplace where individual can come together and they can share the information among themselves. So from this particular concept, if you just try to think of that, what are the total application space, and this is being shown in this third diagram, that if you just try to visualize the total application space, the total application space for blockchain is much more what is being provided by the Bitcoin or such kind of cryptocurrency. So that way we have a lot of different applications which are non-financial, which are beyond cryptocurrencies and which do not need cryptocurrency. And from that particular aspect, blockchains are becoming much more interesting, much more important, and keeping aside all the debates that we have regarding cryptocurrency, you can still develop applications in the blockchain space. So the enterprises, they are adopting blockchain to a very broad range of business applications, so some of which we are going to see in the next few lectures. So if I just try to look into one of the particular application, that is the asset transfer in a business network. Now, typically, if you just think of the auditing process that is being done, that I have multiple different parties, say I have party A, party B, party C and party D, and each of these parties have their own records. Now, these records are the financial transaction records, which are typically maintained by the banks involved with the individual parties, and the auditors, they need to access the record from the bank, they need to access the record from the individual parties, and then they need to validate it manually for the auditing purpose. So this is basically a kind of inefficient process which is also expensive and vulnerable because multiple different parties are involved and their assets are in terms of the financial record, the transaction record, as well as the transaction history and all these details, which are being shared between individuals, and then that are being shared to the auditor, where the auditor actually manually verify all those records and they try to find out whether there is any kind of fraudulent behavior which is there. Well, so such kind of things are very difficult to do manually in a application space, and as I mentioned that such kind of things are much more inefficient, expensive and vulnerable when multiple parties are involved in the business and the auditor need to cross verify the auditing data from multiple different parties. So they need to see that, well, whenever you are claiming that I have procured an item which is say price of 1 lakh from party B, then possibly the auditor need to take the document from party B that, well, the party B has sold that item for 1 lakh and that are the corresponding tax that has been paid, and similarly for party A, the document actually verifies that, well, the party A has taken the or bought the good from party B with a price of 1 lakh while paying for the corresponding tax, and that kind of matching, that kind of verification that the auditor need to do. And many of the times whenever the corresponding say loans or such kind of things are involved, where the banks are also involved in the process, then the auditor also need to access the data from the bank to do this entire validation. So that way the validation becomes tricky and the validation needs kind of lot of interactions, manual interactions among individual parties that make the entire system not only expensive but also vulnerable. And in such kind of application space, blockchain can prove to be much more useful, where you can interconnect all those individual stakeholders, the different parties, as well as the banks, the auditors, on the same blockchain platform, and they can share the information. So all the transactions that are happening between all these parties are already there in the blockchain. So the auditor can automatically verify that whether the things are in order or not. So that provides a kind of provenance and immutability, as well as the finality which are being supported by a typical blockchain architecture or typical blockchain platform. And this kind of application space provides much more opportunity for the enterprises, where the enterprise can automate their process by utilizing the blockchain based architecture or a blockchain based platform, where they can log all the transactions that are happening on top of a blockchain. And because all the information that are being logged on a blockchain are immutable and that is being verified by all the parties who are there in the system, so that way you can get a kind of verifiable immutable log which contains the information, and that information can be used for cross validation or for the auditing purpose, and that provides a lot of scope for the enterprises to automate their process with the help of blockchain. And that brings up a kind of new business model, where even in a decentralized setup you can automate your process. You don't need to share your information with a third party whom you are trusting, and in a kind of complete untrusted setup, people can coordinate with each other and they can share the information with each other. Well, so that is the kind of advantage, or that is the kind of beauty which is being provided by a blockchain in an enterprise application space. Now if I just try to look into that, what are the benefits that we get when we apply blockchain for business? So the four fundamental core of our design of a blockchain are the shared ledger or the distributed ledger, the smart contract, the security properties that are being provided by the blockchain architecture, and the consensus algorithms that we are using to ensure every party to a common goal or to a common place. Now this shared ledger, that is the append only distributed system of record which is shared across the business network, and this shared ledger is ensuring that everyone has the information and they are maintaining the information locally. So we do not have any question about who is going to keep the information, or who is going to have the information, or who is going to maintain the information. So it is something like that. Everyone is maintaining their own information, and the network is helping you to share that information with other in a trustworthy, in a secure way. Well, so that is the advantage of shared ledger, which blockchain bring into place. Then we have the smart contract, which is the kind of most powerful tool of a blockchain-based system. So the smart contract provides you an automatic execution platform where the business terms can be embedded in the form of a transaction in a transactional database, and they can be executed with transactions. Say, for example, whenever a particular organization or a particular enterprise make a transaction, along with that transaction, certain code can be associated, and that code will get executed to validate or to initiate the next step or to initiate the next event. So that way, these different smart contracts can be executed based on the different events which are happening in the system, and this automated execution of the smart contract can facilitate the process of automating the entire end-to-end system. Say, for example, whenever the moment you are uploading your bills or you are uploading your invoice, immediately a smart contract can get executed to transfer the goods with the help of a blockchain-based platform. So that way, the business logic can be automated in your system, which reduces a lot of manual efforts. And that way, it brings up transparency in the system, and it reduces the risk that is getting involved in executing the process manually. So that way, the business automation sees a new direction, a new goal with the help of this kind of smart contract. Then the third pillar of blockchain is the security, as I mentioned, that it ensures that the appropriate visibility of the information across different stakeholders, and the transactions are secure, authenticated, and verifiable. So that way, every transaction that is happening in a blockchain-based system, anyone can verify that transactions, and the way we are executing the transactions remains anonymous. But at the same time, the person who is going to claim that transaction, they can claim the transaction in a secured way. So that is the kind of power which is provided by the blockchain. And finally, this consensus mechanism, which is there at the back end of a blockchain, it ensures that all the parties agree to network verify transactions. So everyone is in the same space, or everyone is in the same frame, where everyone can see the same information and they can take their decision based on the information that they have. So that is the kind of beauty, that is the kind of power which is being provided by a blockchain platform. And this entire four pillars, they reduces the time, reduces the execution time. So the transaction execution get reduced from days to near instantaneous. Then it removes the cost, well, the overheads which are associated with the cost of intermediaries or the third parties, they get removed. Then it reduces the risk. So the tampering, fraud, and cybercrime, that can be reduced because the platform is providing you a tamper-free system. And it also enables new type of business model. So you can possibly integrate the IoT system with your supply chain, where the IoT will continuously monitor that what is the state of the individual products that are being supplied, and that information can get logged in the blockchain, which can possibly automatically trigger the smart contracts depending on the state of the of your product. Say, for example, you are transferring onion in transportation, and if the condition of the onions get bad, say possibly the smart contract can trigger a redirection of the vehicle so that the onion can be delivered in the nearby places to reduce the possible wastage of the product. So that way, you can enable new type of business models with the help of blockchain. So if I just think about that, the power of blockchain, so if you think about the today's typical system which are there, so those systems are following a kind of centralized ledger. So you maintain the information, you share the information manually, and the auditors verify that, well, which is something like 100% centralized. And from that space, this blockchain helps you to decentralize every architecture, and As I mentioned earlier that as you move towards decentralization, you possibly reduce the risk of fraudulent behaviors. And the different kind of decentralized architectures which we have, like if you have a kind of permissionless public shared system, which is like a Bitcoin, that provides 100% decentralization. And the enterprise use cases are something in between of 100% decentralized and 100% centralized. So it provides either a permission public share system or a permission private share system. So the permission public share system means that the system is still public, but the participants who are participating in the system, they get pre-authenticated. So that way they are permissioned. So only a permissioned entity can get participated in your platform, but it is a kind of public platform that anyone can get a verifiable credential and they can join in the system. But on the other hand, there are business use cases, there are enterprise use cases where you can also rely on a permissioned and private shared system where the things only work within a few people who participate in the business procedure. So one of the example where you can possibly use this permission public shared system is the kind of e-commerce platform. So in case of in your e-commerce platform, you can see that there are multiple different sellers, and the sellers can be small sellers, small businesses to large businesses who can participate, but the sellers are pre-authenticated. So it is a kind of public system. Anyone can participate as a seller, but the person need to be pre-authenticated to join the system. On the other hand, there are enterprise use cases like a supply chain management, where a fixed number of enterprises, they come to a consortium and they participate in an end-to-end supply chain procedure. If you remember the example of the oil supply chain or petroleum supply chain that we discussed earlier, that is an example of this permission private share system. So that way the permission model can be public or can be private, and we have support for all these different levels of decentralization, and the blockchain platform actually helping us to move to a specific business model depending on my requirement. So moving from a centralized architecture to different level of decentralization with the help of the blockchain based architecture. So if I just try to compare between the permissionless and permission blockchains, so in terms of access control, in a permissionless model you have open read write access to database, whereas in a permission model you have a permission read write access to database. You need to get pre-authenticated. In terms of scaling, it scale to a permissionless model scale to a large number of nodes, but not in transaction throughput, whereas a permission model, it scale in terms of transaction throughput, but not to a large number of nodes. In terms of consensus, for permissionless model, we use proof of work or proof of stake kind of consensus model, whereas for permission blockchain, it is a closed membership consensus. Typically, we use the Byzantine agreement protocols. In term of identity, the permissionless models assume the anonymous or pseudo-anonymous participants, whereas in case of permission model, the identities of nodes are known, but the transaction identities can be private, anonymous or pseudo-anonymous. In terms of assets, the permissionless model typically use native assets like the coins, cryptocurrencies and so on. The permission model, they can use any asset, any type of data can be shared or any type of state of execution can be shared among the participants. Now, to introduce you with the enterprise blockchain platform that is widely used to develop such kind of enterprise applications. So the Linux Foundation, they have introduced this Hyperledger project. So this Hyperledger project is a collaborative effort that is created to advance the blockchain technology by identifying and addressing important features for a cross-industry open standard for distributed ledgers that can transform the way business transactions are conducted globally. And under this Hyperledger project that we typically call as the Hyperledger Greenhouse, under that there are different type of projects for different purpose. We have Hyperledger Fabric, Hyperledger Grid, Hyperledger Indy, Hyperledger Aries, Hyperledger Sawtooth, Hyperledger Besu, Hyperledger Baro, and so on. And different projects provides different level of decentralization in terms of permissioned model or private public model. And at the same time, they are suitable for different kind of applications. Say, for example, Hyperledger Indy is a popular application or popular blockchain platform to support identity management. So later on, we are going to look into Hyperledger Indy in details. And in the next lecture onwards, you are going to have a tutorial on Hyperledger Fabric, where you will see that how you can build up a business model with an enterprise blockchain platform. So to introduce you with this Hyperledger platform, let me try to show you the environment, the website of this Hyperledger. So you can navigate through this website and you can actually check different kind of projects under Hyperledger which is there. And there is a nice video which actually talks about that, why you should migrate to this one of the projects of Hyperledger to develop your business application. So let me play this video so that you can get an idea.
Hyperledger is an opportunity to change the world.
This is a once in a lifetime opportunity. From the minute I read about blockchain technologies, I knew I had to be a part of it. It was so exciting to me, its potential, that I actually changed careers to do it.
We all know the future is going to be data-driven, it's going to be automated, we're going to have this wonderful sort of decentralized, organic world. The only question is how to get there.
Hyperledger has been really successful in bringing together the people that have business problems with the technology developers who are creating these new capabilities. Bringing these two groups together with this new technology has really started to break the traditional ways that people have thought about solving problems. And open them up to new ways of doing business with new kinds of technology.
It's not just the technology, it's also a level of validation of the impact this technology can have.
You know, Hyperledger has been a great governing body to enable us to freely share our thoughts and ideas. But I think the passion that we see every single day with the community is one that will be felt forever. It's not limited by Hyperledger, but it is enabled and is fostered by Hyperledger.
Community is the bedrock of what we do. Community, I would take a good community with code that is still developing and maturing over great code with no community.
The value of the Hyperledger is the power of the people, the power of the open source.
Hyperledger brings people together that normally would not be in a position to collaborate. The model of open source and the model that the Linux Foundation has established, Hyperledger has adopted that and progressed it to get what might have been former competitors to work together on common solutions.
Without all these developers and all this exchange of ideas and all these bright people, of course, that would not happen.
I'm often amazed at when I go and check out the forums themselves of new areas, and I'll find myself going down rabbit holes into areas that I didn't really know much about, and find that they're quite interesting.
We're all here to try to make a difference. And it's just so invigorating being in that environment where we all have that same objective, and we're all working so relentlessly to make that happen.
It's going to change the way people live their lives, and Hyperledger is right at the middle of it.
If you're in the blockchain space and you haven't engaged with the Hyperledger community and the projects within Hyperledger, I can't recommend more highly that you do so, and do so quickly.
So as you have seen, that this Hyperledger community is really diverse community that actually spans across different companies or different enterprises. And just to highlight you about the members who are associated with this Hyperledger project, it is a large list. So you have already in the video, you have seen that the representatives from tech companies or the tech giants like Microsoft, Accenture, Intel, they have shared their view on Hyperledger. And at the same time, there are financial institutes like Sarbank that have expressed their view on Hyperledger, that why you should use Hyperledger. So if you look into the entire member space, this is just a partial list that I have been able to show in the slide. but there are around 300 plus members in the Hyperledger platform who are building up applications by utilizing such kind of blockchain architecture over Hyperledger. And among these different projects which are there in Hyperledger, this Hyperledger Fabric, it provides a distributed ledger platform on top of which you can build up your own application. So, this Hyperledger Fabric is an implementation of blockchain technology that is the foundation for developing the blockchain applications. So, it provides emphasis on ledger, smart contracts, consensus, confidentiality, resiliency, scalability, all these different aspects of blockchain. So, this version 1.0 of Hyperledger Fabric got released in July 2017, and currently there are around 159 developers from 27 different organizations who participated in this Hyperledger Fabric, development of this Hyperledger Fabric, and it is still growing. So, people are, it is an open source project, so people are contributing their own idea in this platform. So, let me also quickly browse through this Fabric platform to give you a demo of what is Fabric and what the powerful things can be provided by Fabric.
Welcome to the Hyperledger Greenhouse, an open source consortium for developing business blockchain technologies hosted by the Linux Foundation. Within the Greenhouse, diverse global communities collaboratively develop open source projects that uniquely approach enterprise blockchain challenges. These technologies can cross-pollinate and interoperate, just like how the communities driving the projects collaborate in an open and neutral environment. Hyperledger Fabric is an enterprise-grade permissioned distributed ledger platform in the Hyperledger Greenhouse that offers modularity and versatility for a broad set of industry use cases. The modular architecture for Fabric accommodates the diversity of enterprise use cases through plug-and-play components such as consensus, privacy, and membership services. One of the many compelling Fabric features is the enablement of a network of networks. Members of a network work together, but because businesses need some of their data to remain private, they often maintain separate relationships within their networks. Rather than an open, permissionless system, Fabric offers a modular, scalable, and secure platform that supports private transactions and confidential contracts. Fabric helps members manage confidential obligations to each other without first passing it through a central authority. That way, personal data isn't available to the entire network. If a member is not an agreed-upon party, the transaction shouldn't appear on their ledger. This architecture allows for solutions developed with Fabric to be adapted for any industry, thus ushering in a new era of trust, transparency, and accountability for businesses. Get started with Hyperledger Fabric today by downloading the source code, accessing the documentation, and joining our community from our website, hyperledger.org.
So, as I mentioned that this Fabric or any project under Hyperledger that is under the open source community, so you can also be a contributor to this Hyperledger project. So, in conclusion, we have seen today this enterprise blockchain applications and the use cases which are being provided by this enterprise architecture. And in the next lecture, we are going to have a demo on this Hyperledger platform, and we are going to see that how you can develop your own applications on top of Hyperledger. So, that is all for this lecture. Thank you for attending. In the next lecture onwards, we are going to look into a demonstration about this Fabric platform and how you can build up your first application on top of Fabric. Thank you.